Welcome back, everyone. Game number two is here, and after a 75 minute game number one, Minesk against Execration, I've got some thinking to do in the draft as we got ourselves into this lovely, lovely series for the ESL One Genting Southeast Asian Qualifier Grand Final. And the draft has begun. I'm not alone. Thankfully, I have Luminous here to take us through all of this wonderful picking and banning us. We got ourselves into things.
Execration takes on Naga. I find that super funny. I mean, we kind of talked about this during the first drafting phase that, you know, Mineski hasn't been actually first facing Naga, even though they can. They've been opting for things like Slaughter, Ogre Magi, Lifestealer a lot of times, but no Naga this game. And I think after that game, I think we could all do without Naga Siren for a while.
I said to Adam, 343 in the lobby, like, dude, you killed me. You're trying to kill me in game one. And he said to Chemo, okay, we'll ban out the Naga. Give the casters a break. Give the viewers, you know, a little bit of a nicer game. Not so long. I don't know. That game was full of swings and comebacks and a few throws here and there. But it was a hype-ass game between these two Filipino teams. As Mineski open with a Juggernaut, a hero that's been seen... or seeing a lot of first phase bans in Southeast Asia, you know? We're seeing a lot of Juggernaut Ogre double bans, and Mineski finally get their hands on it.
Yep. I'm still thinking about the last game. Remember that there was one time where Miracle dove into the fountain?
Yeah.
So his team could get the mid-racks? Did he have to buy back afterwards? Or did his team defend it without his buyback?
I cannot remember. I know he had buyback. I remember.
Yeah. He definitely had buyback. He wouldn't have done it without the buyback, but I don't think he had to buyback. Like, I'm just thinking, like, at what point was there a big strategical mistake by either team? But, you know, in a game like that, strategy maybe goes out the window. It's all by feels and.
It's all the little things.
Yeah.
Well, Lunar Shadow Demon is no little thing. Great opening combo there from Execration. We saw VP win the summit last night. With a lot of Shadow Demon and Luna, like all the way through the tournament. It's still a relatively common pick as well in Southeast Asia. 10 seconds. Mineski. Have they planned to deal with this? You know, usually you kind of want a lineup that can hit a timing around 15, 20 minutes and, you know, either trade towers or defend towers nicely. How do you feel about Warlock being let through here?
I'm surprised that Mineski did not pick Warlock second. Yeah. I would have said that was a great pick there because we saw Fatal Bond working so well against the 4 or 5 illusion push. Because it's not that you can't kill the illusions, it's more that you can't kill them fast enough. And when you Fatal Bond them up, any kind of AoE stuns that you have on them makes it so much easier. So maybe Mineski is thinking that, look, we're not going to fight them. We're not going to deal with them 40 minutes in the game. We're going to just beat them early. Which is how Mineski won both of their games yesterday, right? They just ran very high-tempo, aggressive strategy against, I believe, Naga one game and against Alchemist another game, and they just ran over their opponents within 20, 30 minutes.
I mean, a lot of that came down to kind of innovative laning stage. They had, Puck safe lane. I can't remember what they threw to... It was Morphling mid, Puck safe lane, and then they ran this kind of aggressive dual lane with a roaming hero as well. And they could do something similar here. You know, Nyx plus one could be towards the offlane, have Juggernaut sit mid for Miracle. But again, it's one of those heroes where both Jay and Miracle can pick up the Juggernaut. Nyx Assassin could go into the hands of Jules or RR. And it's more likely than not going to be the mid Jug and the offlane Nyx. While Execration, you can always bring up the fact that they could look towards an aggro tri lane of their own with Lunar Shadow Demon plus maybe a Bounty Hunter. And I think...
Right.
You do have to be scared of Bounty Heroes Mineski against the Nyx. You know, you have that vision game from the 4 roll, got the tracks coming through, and if Execration, you know, get a few track kills in the first 20 minutes, they can snowball super hard.
3-4-3, what can't this man play? Bounty Hunter definitely within his wheelhouse. I have to say, he does play it quite a bit, right?
Yeah.
I remember seeing him play Bounty, yeah, so... If that's the strat they want, they can have it. I think Nyx Assassin, when it's played as a support, they generally need like a really strong setup for the stun. Shadow Demon is generally his partner. So, like you said, I'm likely leaning towards this as more of a core Nyx.
mean, I think there's only what, like one hero I've not seen 343 play in like the four or five roles, and it's Earth Spirit, because DJ always used to play that on Fnatic.
Okay.
I don't know if he plays too much Earth Spirit, but
Maybe it's still in the workshop. It's not a
yeah.
hero that you could just like, it's like, okay, let me play Earth Spirit support right now without practice.
I mean, if you watch like Lil streamed for a long time, where he would literally just like spam, not even in pubs, but like he'd spam Earth Spirit, the training mode, where the demo mode, where you practice the hero, and he'd spend, 45 minutes, even an hour, just sitting there practicing combinations and rolling and kicking, planting stones and all that. It's one of those kind of cool
Yeah,
heroes that.
that guy's a hero spammer. He would just like pick Visage in a pub and go mid to practice it. He's like the best Visage player in the world, and he still like practices his hero, so.
Yeah, gotta keep fresh. Gotta stay
Yeah.
sharp. Sand King for Execration. No big surprise that. Again, could be 4-all for them. Or towards the offlane. Relatively open with the remainder of their draft. While Mineski. Warlock is still available. I mean, is there any big reason you can think of to not go for the Warlock? Maybe just like too slow paced with the ultimate cooldown? If they do want
No,
to
I
go
think it's
for
quite
a.
good. I think it's great. I talked about the how good it is against the Shadow Demon Luna combination. Even though the cooldown of your rock is pretty long, the cooldown of Eclipse is quite
Execration
long as well. So you
stand
can kind of mirror Luna's ult with your ult. But instead, again, they're going to go for a little bit more lane domination. And as it sits right now, Execration doesn't exactly have the best tomb killers. Luna technically is a ranged hero, but very low
10
range one at
seconds
that.
remaining.
So, yeah, looking for some lane domination.
This
5
is the
seconds
Mineski that we
remaining.
know and love. Get these lanes won and try and roll yourself
Mirage.
through the game. Mirana comes out from Execration.
Dire team
And again, you're
lead.
still never quite sure where these heroes are going to go. I guess mid Mirana is more likely than not here. It could be the 343 roaming Mirana. Again, that's kind of one of his favorite heroes to play and move around the map and
10
control things
seconds
up.
remaining.
Another hero that can right-click into the tombstone if required.
Five
It's all
seconds
about that
remaining.
arrow with a disruption combination. Now, Mineski come back with a Morphling,
Execration
and this is
stand
one of the
down.
kind of strats or playstyles that I feel like I enjoy the most. It's the kind of 4 plus 1, where Miracle, the first like 10 minutes or so, he can play aggressively on lanes. He'll start waveforming, they'll put pressure on a lane with him, and then 15 to
10
25,
seconds remaining.
he'll be farming side lane. He'll be like sort of, innocuously away,
5 seconds
hiding somewhere,
remaining.
farming on a lane. Freezes the wave at a tier 1, but has a replicate like always near fights that are breaking out, and then he'll just
Dire
jump in,
team
join the
back.
fight, and turn a 3v3 into a 4v3, make up the numbers, and come in with a couple of
Yeah.
kills.
Miracle and Shadow from Wings are the two Morphling players that, to me, has the highest participation rate for such a farm intensive hero. And
10
like you said, with
seconds
the replicate,
remaining.
you can do it. It's just that a lot of the other Morphling players don't have as good as like presence of mind to
Dire
constantly
team
be
pick.
on the lookout for fights. They're more or less on the lookout to like stay alive and farm, which is priority number one for Morphling. But it seems like for these two players, and Miracle in particular, he wants to get kills. He wants to join in and fight. And the Morphling pickup really explains the Undying pickup as well, because
10 seconds
if Mineski
remaining.
wanted to just go for kind of stable, safe lanes, Warlock would have been it.
5
But
seconds
Warlock
remaining.
wouldn't have would be unable to harass mid as effectively as Undying can. And I imagine Undying is
Reserve
going to start
time.
mid to decay a bit, allow Morphling to get that level 2 or 3.
10 seconds
Because yesterday we
remaining.
saw Morphling when he's being played by Miracle, he goes to like the 380
5
HP, the
seconds
400 HP,
remaining.
very low HP early on. And if you get harassed down like that,
Berserker.
it's not great. So the Undying most likely will sit in his
Execration's
lane
turn to
and
pick.
give him the assistance.
Disruptor from Mineski. Going to be one of those heroes that, if Execration do sort of push into a tower and have to disengage and retreat, can always drag back one of the targets and potentially turn one kill into two and into more,
10 seconds remaining.
as they can swing things around nicely there. Crystal Maiden, I think, was
Five
a really good ban,
seconds
though.
remaining.
That kind of enabling hero, allowing Undying to just continually roam, the mana aura,
Reserve
giving him
time.
pretty much infinite decays through that laning stage. This is where Execration maybe show their hand, and we get a glimpse of where the Sand King and Mirana are actually going to be heading. We can maybe assume that offlane Sand King, mid Mirana, but I don't know if Execration very rarely leave their support until last, right? So I feel this
No,
is more likely
I
to
think
be
this is
a
Mirana support.
You think it's Morana support? Yeah, I feel like one of the other, Sand King or Morana, are going to be supports, and this is, I guess if you think about it that way, this is going to be the mid hero, right, for Abed.
Yes.
Yeah.
Or it could be a mid Gabby. Like Abed could also play Luna. So they're very similar to Mineski in the sense that the mid and core player does swap quite a bit.
No role attributions are set in stone for these teams, which is always nice to see. Dragon Knight is going to be the pickup for Execration. Adds into the tower push, and this. I mentioned VP with a Shadow Demon Luna. This feels like a VP draft. The only thing that's missing is like a Lil support Weaver or something like that.
I think the bigger thing for this Dragon Knight final pick is that you have now two cores that could get BKB. I mean, you saw a Disruptor last pick. So if you get BKB core, suddenly heroes like Nyx Assassin, Disruptor, even to a certain degree, the Morphling, relies a ton on their magic damage output. And if you get that early BKB, they really can't do that much. Also, again, I mentioned that Morphling hangs a bit low on the strength. A good Fire Breath will kind of bring him extremely low, but we're gonna switch things around. It's a Raging Potato Morphling and a Miracle Juggernaut instead. Okay.
Okay. So I guess that means it'll be mid Juggernaut against the Dragonite to put the Morphling to the bottom lane and get that secured farm for them. As the off lane from Execration, what is it, just going to be DJ on his own? Like 343 is going to be kind of roaming around, but can the Morana go and stand up top with the Sand King and maybe apply that little more pressure? Just right click into maybe the Disruptor or the Morphling in the initial stages?
He might have to. I think 343 might actually go with him a little bit. The weakness of this Shadow Demon Morana combination is that whenever you see one of them gone, like you could be expecting that they're actually together looking for a gank and looking for a kill. Because you know, like for example, if Mineski, one of their supports are gone, you know, Ninja could be Buki could just be like pulling, Disruptor could be ganking, but it's so obvious when the Execration supports are gone because they have to be gone together. That is the weakness of like Shadow Demon Kunkka, Shadow Demon Nyx, that kind of setup.
They're still putting the Morphling mid, it looks like, Mineski. I've pulled a couple of tangos, and Miracle's got the safe lane build. So it's
Okay.
even more interesting. Because usually Miracle does play that mid Morphling, but it's as we thought during the draft. You know,
2 seconds
Morphling plus Undying mid, just secure that lane, get the bottle up and running, spam decay down onto that Dragon Knight. Abed will be playing up on that one. Chemo, Shadow Demon with Gabby's Luna, all converging towards this top rune. With 343 hiding up on top of the cliff. Miracle Jewels and Raging Potato are lurking around, but fighting into this is so difficult with just one disruption to set things up. Could be nasty
The
for them.
battle
DJ,
begins.
he doesn't have a Burrow Strike, so RR will stun him down and get that bounty rune for himself. It's Caustic Finale level 1. And double mangoes for the Nyx Assassin, while DJ is a stout and one mango. Nice little camp block up there from RR. Make sure there's no stacks done up by the Sand King down on this bottom lane, but it's an aggro try. Gabby, Chemo, and 343 already moving themselves into position for this.
Yeah, I like the aggro try because you don't have to split up your support duo. They're much weaker when split up. And more importantly, you also force a lot of pressure on the top lane. So it might force Ninja Boogie to go up top. We talked about the importance of Ninja Boogie mid, giving Raging Potato that early level 2 unharassed. But he might have to go up top and help out his friends because anybody that gets disrupted is straight up dead. So even if you have the spin, the arrow could be land on top of you that as soon as you come out, even before you could press the spin button, you're stunned.
I mean, you can still spin after disruption before arrow, but you get stunned, but you don't take the damage. Because
Are you okay? You sure about that?
yeah, it's the same with Astral and like Rage and Carapace and all these things. There's like a window between them where you
Right.
can BKB spin Rage or Carapace, but the stun always hits first. It's like stun and then you cast your spell and then the damage hits, so you're actually able to block out the damage. That's why it was always weird when, like, Lifestealer against Bane Mirana, you know, back in, what was it, like, TI3, the Bane would Nightmare, and the arrow would land, but Lifestealer would, like, rage and get stunned by arrow at the same time, and it wasn't until, like, the combat log started getting used that we realized what was happening.
Okay, well, hopefully we'll see that interaction once this game and see exactly how it plays out. Ninja Boogie did actually go up top for a bit, but it looks like he's checking the rune again. And then we have the passive 1v1 in the lane in the bottom. I think overall, pretty static lanes. I give the advantage to the Sanking with the caustic against any melee hero. And you can see that Aura, despite having Tangles and double Mango regen, he's having a tough time here.
Haste from dying. Get back in the face of Abed, who's forced a lot of regen out of Jay here. The Morphling's still a little short of that bottle. Needs to get a few more CS in, but Abed's actually having a really good time mid, even though he's against the dual lane. And of course, you've got to consider the fact that Morphling will be at a slight experience deficit the way things are going. So they move the Undying to bottom. Looks like they want to try and pressure this. Sanking a little more there. I don't know if you're content just leaving Miracle to like leech experience, though. He's being pushed away from the creep wave. He can't CS, and he can't really get up in the faces of anyone. It's 3-4-3. He's picking out, kind of realizing that Jules is lurking around in the trees, and they're trying to cut through, but it's being spotted. Disruptor knows.
Yeah, Miracle has been put into this situation by his team quite a bit, and I think he's okay with it. He's really learned to play the comeback role. He's not gonna have a lot of farm right now, but he'll be able to catch up. So I'm not exactly too concerned. I'm more concerned about the fact that the mid lane is not as big of a domination as we ex expected. I think Mineski expect to win the lane a little bit more as well, and Abed is fine, again, holding his own.
A little bit surprising. And 3-4-3. Oh, he's actually looking to cut in behind tier 1 and tier 2 mid, but the courier is already upgraded and flying this bottle across onto the Morphling, so Morana's still on level 2. We'll swing back up towards the top. Still yet to see this disruption to Arrow combo, but again, they want to go on the Disruptor. They're pinging out Jules. That is like the one hero that they can kill. They've cut themselves, again, away through the trees, but Arrow's expended there by 343 to kill off a big old Wild Wing. And bottom, DJ. The Carapace is there. Ninja Boogie throws down another Decay with a Soul Rip. DJ does drop low, but holding onto the salve means that he can just heal himself back up to full. That's lots of mana expended by Mineski, and that's a lot of their aggressive potential now gone down the drain, pretty much.
Top lane,
Glimpse
Kimo
back.
Gonna get Glimpse back, and that should be a kill. Well, the disruption trying to get forced out. He might disrupt himself in the very last second. He does. He needs some sick illusion jukes, but looks like the real one has been found. Body block coming out from Gabby. They will save Kimo. Kimo turns around, drops the Soul Catcher. Gonna focus on Jules instead. Jules needs that healing ward. Miracle not microing it to him. First blood goes to Gabby. Very nice turnaround. I thought for sure he was gonna die there, but
Stick charges.
Kimo makes it work. Yeah.
Stick charges and body blocks. Execration. Get away with murder. Turn
Oh, I
around,
love the
sir.
fact that he's not going for the poison build too.
Oh yeah, absolutely. He's gone for the 2-1. Disruption of the Soul Catcher. Very good stuff. As Undying denied himself to a neutral down a bottom lane, no big deal. But Sand King, 22-1. The Nyx has kind of breached the gap and moved himself a wave ahead of the SK for now. But again, RR has a Quelling Blade PMS. Plays aggressively forward into DJ, and it's aggressive dual lane. But up at top, they've found Jules again. Disruption into setup, and it's gonna be a simple kill, I think, there, even with a glimpse back. Does that remove Gabby from experience range? I think it might have, but still, it's a dead disruptor, and the two supports will find themselves a nice amount of golden experience.
Yeah. Once again, Mineski lose out on most of the lanes. You know, coming in 1 week ago, if this happened in ROG Master, I would have said for sure it's Mineski that's gonna win the series quite easily, in fact, but
3-4-3 effect.
yeah, with every pass and every game, it seems like Execration plays a little bit better. Maybe Mineski hasn't trained as hard. I'm not exactly sure what the case is, but they need to really ignite their engines. Let's go, guys.
What happened to the intro, boys? What happened to that lane domination and early aggression? Mineski will move this level 6 Nyx Assassin with a Vendetta up towards the top lane and hunt down Kimo, but the sentry, oh, it spots him. They know he's there. RR. Kimo, I think, gives it away there a little bit. That Nyx Assassin's first rotation will come to nothing as Ninja Boogie is given bottom lane experience, but free farm DJ, mid lane, the Dragonites, you know, going ham on these creeps. Currently sitting at the top of the net worth, 2800 with the Luna just behind him. And Juggernaut, we keep looking at this Miracle Jug and thinking if maybe he'd be in the mid lane, things would be a bit nicer, but I guess you couldn't have had Morphling plus Disruptor top against this aggressive trial lane. That would have gone
No,
even worse.
Yeah, for sure, for sure. Because Juggernaut, despite being a melee hero, is actually much tankier. Morphling will survive, but I think Morphling actually farms less because every time he walks in for a CS, he'll get pummeled much harder.
And you don't want to buy
Bottom
PMS
lane?
on Morphling, really, yeah. Undying dies to DJ and 343 as they combo up nicely there. Up at top. I won't go in on them just yet. Again, chipping away with a Lucent Beam is very nice, but Dragon Form from Abed. RR. Coming back into position, he'll land a stun, but the damage is lacking here. And Raging Potato, very low on HP, cannot turn to fight up against it. Another Dragon Tail is ready. Abed might be able to go for this with an arrow to follow through, but won't have the range on it while the Nyx Assassin pops himself to invis. I've got no reveal here, and I think RR with enough mana for another stun in. They
Wait
waveform
for
forward. Oh, Raging Potato with the low HP play. Actually goes in with a kill, blocks off the arrow line. And we'll be able to TP back to Fountain, jumps in with the replicate there as well. Bottle regens
Wait
up, and now the
for
stun will not land. The waveform ready from Raging Potato jumps forward, and there we go. A double kill for the Morphling. Perfect play out from Mineski.
Well, that was actually perfect play by Bimble. The fact that he made the dragon form right as Dragonite turned range, that illusion actually did a lot of corrosive damage the whole fight, and then he still had time to port back in after TPing back to base. That was somebody make a gif of that. That was actually just perfect by Mineski.
He's got the smooth moves.
Yeah.
And he's actually going to go for the treads here, it looks like. So, bottle treads for Morphling. Quite often we see sort of brand boots into Dragonlance or boots of travel, something along those lines. But early aggression is what we want to see from them. So, treads for the mid Morphling is going to be sick. Bottom lane, DJ's going in onto Ninja Boogie. Jules has died up at top. The Luna's found that kill. The stun from RR finds the Sand King, actually. Another Burst Strike's ready from DJ to escape if he needs it. But even under those tower hits, he will be fine. Ninja Boogie, very low, 25 HP there from that final caustic hit through onto him as Arrow won't land. And now they disrupt him up. And Miracle doesn't even need to spin. He's perfectly fine just walking this one off. But they glimpse back 343. The leap is available. He holds it as long as he can to turn back and fight Miracle here under this tier 1 tower.
Nope, more TP back in. I think they wish they would have Glimpse now, but it's long on cooldown. In
Oh, the
fact, Glimpse
Eclipse!
being turned around here. Gabby wants to fight. He gets the one kill. Morphling has waved in. He doesn't have replicate. He gets Soulcatcher, and he's done. Welcome back, Soulcatcher. We miss you. And Gabby, continue his domination this game around.
And the Juggernaut died to the Dragon Knight. This Abed rotation came in from the south, moves forward, kills off the Jug, then finds the tower. DK. Level 8.5 now with 1300 gold saved up in the bank. Even though he died towards the mid lane, he's sitting pretty. Third place on the net worth, and the big question always is, right, who gets the Blink Dagger first from the initiators? DJ, he's on 1300 gold. So's RR, so it's pretty close between the two of them, you know, very similar in terms of net worth. Is there a bigger impact from either one of them? Like, do you expect the Sand King Blink to be maybe a little more potent than the Nyx's one?
If you talk about vacuum, I think both hero getting a blink is big, but it's more so that the Sand King blink sets up much more on the team, right? It's a blink into an arrow. It's a blink into a secondary stun from the Dragonite. Anybody essentially getting blinked on the side of Mineski will just straight up die to execration. So I think the Sand King blink is much more important in this game. Also, if you look at Mineski's lineup, what exactly is their kind of team fight capability in the mid game? Like, if you look over Undying, he has 0 points of Tombstone. So it's going to be a long while before he has the max Tombstone. Disruptor is not great in terms of mid game because he's underleveled, and Storm is not that great of a spell against Disruption. We have a TP out by 343. He will survive the gank up top. Meanwhile, looks like Gabby picks up another one on bottom.
Morphling dead again. I want to look at this Undying. You've mentioned there's no points in Tombstone. Now, I'm a big fan of the kind of 2-2 build into Decay and Soul Rip early on. But going for a third point in Decay and leveling up your ultimate here from Ninja Boogie, I'm struggling to understand why. Does he feel like Tombstone's just going to get clicked down by DK and Mirana? Like, he feels it's not worth it?
I think so. Maybe he's saying that his team doesn't have enough lockdown to take advantage of Tombstone. Because your Tombstone not getting right click down is one thing, but also if you drop Tombstone, how are you keeping them in that Tombstone area? Mid tower, not gonna get denied. Burrow Strike into, or sorry, Dragon Tail, not into Burrowstrike. I think if Vizier had Burrowstrike, the arrow would have hit. And that would have been a dead Morphling, but...
It definitely looked like it. The pings come out on bottom. Mineski wants to fight Gabby. And Ninja Boogie moves forward. With his ulti there, the Flesh Golem and the Static Storm. They'll find the Lunar under the tower. The Moonlight Shadow was popped to try and save him, but the Dominating Streak is taken out by Jules. And now they converge down on this bottom lane. And likely look for that Tier 1, but Execration... They can bring people down here to defend this. They have the Sand King Blink. They've got Epicenter in 30 seconds time, and Mineski, they're going to struggle to actually do any physical damage to that tower without Juggernaut there. So they've got to like go back and farm.
Yeah, Mineski, it's in their best interest to drag this game out at least in the next 10 to 15 minutes without any kind of team fight, any kind of tower contest. But Abed, invis'd up, he sees the... That's a dead disruptor. Arrow's gonna hit from the backside. And there's that tombstone, but it's a level one. So thanks for the gold. In fact, Ninja Boo gets his demonic purged up. He is also dead.
Yeah. He tries to soul rip himself through, but the Lucent Beam from Luna. Top lane, DJ gets waveformed on, but Raging Potato drops low to the Burrow Striking Caustic Finale. RR is hunting in the back, looking for DJ Sand King, but SK has Blink already, while RR is still a good 300 gold away from it. And that tier 1 push that was potential there from Mineski in bottom lane, it swung around and it's another tower here from Execration. And one by one, they're just dropping these towers like absolutely nothing. Gabby has got himself Dragonlance moving into Yasha. And this is where the snowball of Execration's lineup really comes to fruition. This is where things get really super dangerous for Mineski if they try and contest towers, if they try and fight. Everything has to be, you know, crisp and perfect. And they have to find the numbers advantage before the fight kicks off.
Yeah, if Execration wants to go for a big strong timing attack, Abed could just go straight BKB, Luna could go Yasha BKB. They could just straight up win the game, because you talked about Mineski's physical damage is lacking. They're essentially relying all on magic, and you just shut that door in terms of the path of comeback for Mineski. What can they exactly do if there's double BKB on the course?
Sit back and cry? Fetal position on the floor? I'm not sure. I mean, Juggernaut, level 1 Omni Slash, even that's not going to do anything. There's the indication that Mineski have realized and will address this issue. Midas on the Nyx Assassin. RR, he's prone to going the Midas, unlike DJ. But I think in this game in particular, the Blink Dagger's not going to really accomplish anything, because with Blinks, what you usually look for is kind of... Oh, hello. DJ just kills Disruptor straight up. Miracle's forced away from the lane as well, and this Sand King on his own just bullying these guys out.
Yeah.
But with Blinks on offlaners, I guess, most of the time you're looking not just for that initiation tool and not just for, hey, I've got Blinks done, but it's cohesive timing with the rest of your team, right? You're looking for usually a Blink on an offlaner and, let's say, Lifestealer or an Armlet. You're looking for Blink on an offlaner and an Armlet or a BKB or a Dragonlance, you know, your core heroes to have that kind of one stat item so they can go and push forward as Morphling. Oh, he's caught. This J Morph is dead as well. The TP's come through, but the disruption's down. The Static Storm whiffs completely. They don't catch on to anyone, and Abed sprinting around, hasted up, glimpsed into the storm, but Mineski don't do any damage here, and the high ground push will come through from Execration. They've got Dragon Form up again. That's a nice chunk of damage there. The Late Fury will... sure he doesn't get hit by the Burrow Strike. Abed stick charges up. The Eclipse comes through though with the damage.
God.
Oh, Mineski shredded by their own base.
This game
might just be over, Lumi. They're looking for tier 3 in high ground 15 and a half minutes into this game. An Execration from what we thought and what we've seen in the past month or so were the underdogs coming into this series. Maybe not major underdogs, but definitely not the favorites to win it. And Mineski looking like they might be two games down in this best of five. The Juggernaut dead to Lucent Beam. No buyback available, and you've lost a lane of Rax at 16 minutes. Well, oh dear.
I would say a lot of it is drafting advantage that Execration had, but two games in a row, they won their lanes. Very, very hard, in fact. The 1v1 did not go well for the Nyx Assassin. Top lane got shredded. Mid lane was even, but Morphling one of those heroes that takes a while to come online, and they had their nice play on the mid lane, right? Where, you know, the Replicate on the DK kill, and then he put it back to base, and then got mana for a secondary kill. That was great, but I think just too little.
And guess what? 343 is not playing Naga this game, but he's still finding a way to transition. 700 gold away from an Aghanim's on this four-roll Mirana as he throws a fishing arrow
out. Why
is out.
This guy so good?
He's just very good at Dota 2. I don't know. He's glimpsed back now, but the kinetic field won't hold him. Starstorm's there, but the waveform will secure that kill. I think you jinxed him a little bit there.
Yeah, well, you gotta support Mirana. Congrats.
I mean, 343 has like one of the longest names in Dota, right? That's why he's so good.
Yeah. I guess.
You guess. Well, I'll be dead for 15 seconds. I can come back though with DK ulti up. Luna has Eclipse in 20 seconds. And is that a full Manta? Yeah, of course. It's a full Manta for Gabby. With the ranks falling out of mid lane, it's just a huge influx of gold. Aghanim's for DJ's nearly done. And losing ranks isn't all about the creep waves. It isn't all about the big creeps coming out of your opponents. A lot of it is to come down to that huge influx of cash that comes through once. So these support heroes that all of a sudden have Urn Arcanes on Shadow Demon and they're hunting for Raging Potato. I think they know, though.
Yeah.
It's a good waveform away.
Gabby went in a little bit too soon. I don't think he faded completely yet under the Moonlight Shadow and they get the kill, but... Well, Dragon Form level 2. There is no BKB on Expiration, but not that they need it. In fact, they have Illusion Roots.
Okay. Okay. That's just absolutely disgusting. Nyx tries to hold them back with Juggernaut spinning forward as well. The waveform from Jay is just frustration incarnate there as he doesn't hit onto anything. The illusion's already dead. The Dragonite descends forward another one. Tier 3 dropping low. The Glaives will bounce back onto the Morphling at the same time. And with a Glyph available, they might look to pop it once they breach high ground and move on towards the Rax. But Jules is dying. Just to the illusions, and there's no rush here from Execration. They can just slowly, surely chip away at buildings. The Burst Strike, have they got a stun? The Dragonite goes forward, they chain it nicely. Damage output not quite good enough though, as the Glimpse will not accomplish anything whatsoever. Miracle spins forward aggressively. He's on his own. The Demonic Purge is there. The physical damage comes through. The Static Storm is dropped. Miracle, oh, he survives through it, but finally dies. The SD pop, and now the Epicenter from DJ into the back lines with the Eclipse from Luna flying through from the moon, and Ninja Boogie somehow survives through it all, but the buybacks from Mineski come to the fight and die back from Miracle. The Juggernaut's dead again. GG is called. Game number 2. It's a 20-minute affair as Execration sweep the floor with Mineski.
Yep, they saw the Disruptor as a support, sense a ton of weakness in that lane, and they took full advantage of it. Ninja Boogie helped out mid and helped out bottom, but I honestly thought he should have just parked himself up top, because that was a lane that to me mattered the most. Not exactly about Miracle's farm per se, but more so about the scaling of the two supports on the side of the Radiant. I think they just got way too much out of that top lane for Execration.
Well, we've gone from a 75-minute game to a 20-minute game. And game number 2 coming to an end, we'll find out. Game number 3 coming up in a few minutes. A short break and we'll be back with the remainder of this best of 5. SEA qualifier, grand finals for ESL1 Genting. We'll continue in a little bit.